First thing I want to know, does everyone in the world call you Tony, or is there like a TL or an AL, anything like that?
I don't quite know what you mean.
Well, for example, Paul McCartney's real name is not Paul. It's James Paul McCartney.
Oh, I didn't know that. My name's Tony. Anthony is my full name, but my mother called me Anthony. Nobody
you'll
said.
Find sometimes notable musicians, everyone in the crew has a different name from them, so they don't call them the name that necessarily the fans or the listeners do. So I didn't know if there was a secret. Oh, no, I'm Anthony to everybody, but on stage I'm Tony.
Well, unfortunately, in this tour, Robert Fripp, who does our set list each night, maybe you know this if you've seen my website, my web diary, Robert Fripp one night wrote as a piece, Tony Cadenza, meaning that I would improvise whatever I wanted. Sure. And I knew as soon as I saw it in writing that everybody's going to start joking about the supposed New Jersey Italian pizzeria owner, Tony Cadenza. And indeed that happened. So I have the pleasure of being right, but I have the displeasure of being kind of convoluted with Tony Cadenza. Sure.
Well, another big tour for you guys. It would be, 7 or 8 years in a row had it not been for COVID. So it's great how productive that King Crimson has been as a band. Something that amuses me is I don't know of a band that's gone from arena to theater to arena to theater to arena more than King Crimson. Do you like playing in bigger venues? Does it matter to you for your performance?
That's a very good question. And we played plenty of clubs along the way also. Usually once you get up to arenas, you don't go back, but we did go back and that's fine. I don't really have a preference. It's about the music. I think most musicians I work with, it's that way. Some of the best, most fun things I do are in clubs. You're making less gross money, of course, in a club, but you're there for the music. And sometimes arenas have really bad sound, and that detracts from the fun of it. This time we're playing a lot of outdoor shows, and that can't be beat. People can be spaced and feel safe, and we can have not that reverberating arena sound that can be pretty awful, for especially if you happen to play busy music, which of course we do.
Yeah, when you were putting together this tour, did you guys know from the beginning that the Zappa Band would be opening? Or in other words, was it a preconceived co-headlining-ish kind of tour? Or is it, we're going to play great venues. Hey, Zappas, do you want to do it?
I must admit, I'm not involved in the management agency stuff, but I think that going back to last November, December, that was the plan, to ask them to tour, maybe even before that, was to ask them to open with up for us. And for the opening segment of the tour, sorry, for the first leg of the tour, we had another opening act, my good friends, the California Guitar Trio, a very different kind of band and wonderful progressive, but playing acoustic guitars and playing an amazing assortment of music. And some shows we had both. We had three acts on the bill. So that's all been fun. But this tour leg coming up, it's the Zappa Band, and I've heard them nightly. They're wonderful and really a challenge for me as a bass player to hear the amazing bass playing going on there. And
yeah,
great fun. So it's a good duo act, and we're happy to have them.
Anytime you have a big tour like this, there's all sorts of backup plans and insurance policies, because the end game is let's get this big show happening.
Yeah.
A lot of bands, you find that the guitar tech, the drum tech, they can play every song easily. In fact, there may be better players than the people who are on stage. How are the King Crimson techs? Could any of them actually fill in on a moment's notice if needed?
I actually don't know. Like most bands don't know, because we're not there when they're playing our instruments. When we show up, they hand us the instruments. I have heard of things like that, but probably not in progressive rock bands where they're very technical. And indeed, Michele Russotto, my Italian bass tech for many, many years, probably could play a lot of the parts. He certainly tunes the basses and the stick, which is not easy to tune. He tunes them perfectly, but I haven't actually asked him. And I think it would be a rare, I think some of the guitar techs do play guitar, and I haven't heard them noodling and playing the King Crimson pieces. Possibly they could.
Got it. You mentioned the stick, the almighty Chapman stick.
Yeah.
When did you first pick that up, and who was the first Chapman stick player you were aware of?
Well, I heard about it in 1976 when Emma Chapman came out with it. Maybe he had advertised it a little bit in the year before, but I only heard about it in 76 and I got it right away. Because at that time I played the bass sometimes with a tapping technique, which is the technique you use on the stick. And so I thought, well, this would be an interesting way to kind of look at my bass playing in a different way. So I got it. And I know the year because I brought it to Peter Gabriel's first solo album sessions, which was in July 76. He had just left Genesis. And I know that date. So that's how I know, because I remember opening the stick and the producer seeing it and saying, put that thing away. I don't even want to see it, let alone hear it. And it was very gratifying many years later when the same producer hired me for some sessions and asked me to particularly be sure to bring the stick and play it. It's an interesting, fascinating instrument with a different technique, but also as a bass player, I find it has a different attack. Of course, it's hammer-on, so that gives me, and it also has different tuning. And those two things give me different options to approach the music, which in progressive music, you kind of want to, I kind of want to approach it differently than I have before. So the tools that are different kind of tools help my brain to look at the same old piece in a different way. So it's been very useful through the years, and most especially with King Crimson and Peter Gabriel.
It sounds like it keeps you from getting bored of the bass when you have an instrument that helps you refine technique that you can switch back and forth with.
That's an interesting way to look at it. I wouldn't use those words, but something like that. I don't actually get bored. I'm always challenged playing the bass, even playing simple parts. And I do, you're looking at my home studio here. I do a lot of recording on simple records, and I'm challenged by that. And I try and do it really as musically well as I can and as technically well. But I don't often get to put it this way, but having your fingers on the same four or five strings for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, after a while, it's pretty hard to make them do things that they haven't done. So just the fact of putting the strings backwards and tuning them in fifths instead of fourths, which the stick has, makes you reimagine the part or makes you think the part, helps me to think the part in my brain and then find a way to play it on the instrument instead of letting my fingers do the same old, same old.
Something else that's super impressive to me about your career, besides the success, besides how skilled you are, besides nobody really has negative things to say about Tony Levin, besides all that, it's how you've been able to juggle all these different projects over the years. You know, Peter Gabriel's gig, King Crimson, you've been in and out of a few times. You've done all sorts of session work and guest trios, all that kind of stuff. How does that work with scheduling? Do you kind of have this calendar and you go, hey, everyone, not available then? Or have you been kind of lucky where you've been available when you needed to be over the years?
Good, very good question. I've been lucky and I've been unlucky, both. The things that you've heard me play, I was lucky. The great things that I never got to do, I was unlucky. It's the same, not just in music, but any freelance person, the person who delivers your firewood or something, or the plumber, gets busy and has to turn down maybe some good jobs if they're conscientious. Unconscientious people will take it all and kind of shuffle and try and wangle a way to do it all. I don't do that. If I commit myself to a session or a tour, I'll do it. So hence when the Pink Floyd tour that I was offered overlapped by a couple of weeks with the Peter Gabriel tour, I felt, much as I would have liked to do the Pink Floyd tour, I'm going to stick with Peter. I'm not going to, after all these years, say, hey, I can't make the last couple of weeks of the tour. So that's one where I wasn't too lucky, but generally, well, it varies a lot, but on the whole, I've been lucky. And these last few years, maybe 10 years or 20 years, there's a little less touring than there used to be. In the 80s and 90s, we just went out solid. The King Crimson tours would be 6 or 8 months instead of 6 or 8 weeks per tour leg. And so it was harder then to, it was easier to fill in the time, but harder to get them to coincide. And I was very lucky early in the 80s that Peter Gabriel's management and King Crimson's management, when I told them about this new thing called email in the early 80s, that they were happy to be in touch with each other and work out their tours so I could do both.
The best example or comparable example I can think of is the way that you've been with Peter Gabriel and King Crimson is like how Eric Singer was drumming for both Alice Cooper and Kiss. And they kind of had to go, oh, Alice is going on a tour, Kiss can't book a tour and vice versa. Yeah. I can't think of two examples besides you and him that's the case with, but I'm sure you can in your decades of, you know, being cool with all the other side people.
Yeah, well, you're very kind to think of that. I actually don't think about that too much. I think we're all, we're happy when we're lucky, and when it works out, we can't do something good, especially some albums that are just a few days of great stuff, but they came in at the last minute and we had bookings, so we're sad to miss those.
Well, a friend of mine who's originally from Rochester, he's in a band called Long Wave. They did a couple of albums on RCA. They're still doing it. I know you have some Rochester roots. And I said, hey, I'm going to be speaking to Tony Levin. And he goes, oh, yeah, Steve Gadd went to my high school. And then, you know, connected the whole thing. Yeah. So going through your discography, his name is Steve Schiltz. He's a big, big Beatles fan. And he goes, hey, did you know that Tony played on two Beatles solo albums? Like, wow, that's incredible. He was curious. When you're in the studio with John Lennon, does he tell you how to play bass? Or does he go, you're good, you do your own thing?
His first words to me were, they tell me you're good, just don't play too many notes. And I laughed at that because I was so comfortable being with an in-your-face New Yorker kind of attitude that I'm used to. And B, he didn't know it, but I actually don't play too many notes. I think I'm pretty on the sparse side because somebody told him I was a good player. He was thinking, oh, he must be one of those fast guys and I don't want him ruining my music. And that's the last thing I want to do. So that was the end of the discussion. He heard what I played. He liked it. I could tell he liked it because some of the parts he said he liked some of it, and the other parts he doubled. He had other instruments double them after I was gone. So it was a very wonderful experience, of course. And through it, I felt like I wasn't in awe of John. Like I wasn't nervous and shaking like, oh my God, I'm in the studio with John Lennon. But I was thrilled to be around him. But musically, I felt I almost laughed when he would pick up the guitar and play a new song of his, a John Lennon song. I thought, well, playing this bass part, there's easily 1,000 or maybe 10,000 bass players who could do it pretty darn well. How lucky am I to be the one that's here in the studio and you know, just enjoying that fact and just playing the bass part that maybe not too different than anybody would have played. And enjoying the moment. And it was great. It was too short. I wish it had been longer. The sessions themselves were about 2 weeks. And there was a talk of doing a world tour afterwards, but it never happened, sadly.
And tragically. You continued working with Yoko after that. So obviously you were in his good graces and her good graces.
Yeah, well, it wasn't hard to go back. Musically, it was pretty tricky to go back and forth because she couldn't play the song and sing it the way he could. But you know, I respect them both and did my best with both.
Do you miss anything about living in Rochester? I ask that because I'm finding more and more people who make it in entertainment are from there. And the answer is usually, I miss the people. I miss Nick Tahoe's, but otherwise, and House of Guitars. Otherwise, no.
I liked the city. I lived there for only 6 years and I have visited many times. And I have a lot of friends, almost family kind of friends. And so I like going back there. I never disliked the city at all. And but the players from there were great. And I had a lot of my musical education, although I went there to go to classical music school, the Eastman School of Music, my musical education was mostly in jazz and then a little bit in rock. And it was a good education because there were so many really good players there. So I loved that, the players, and I still do. And I loved the scene, the musical scene, the way on a Saturday night at 1 a.m., if you went to IHOP, you'd see all the bands in town after their gigs would join there. When I first moved from there to New York and started working, and I would meet players and I'd say, well, where's the place where everybody meets after the gigs in New York City? And they didn't know what I was talking about. The ones from smaller towns did, but I very much missed that when I went to New York. And now that I'm living in Kingston, New York, a much smaller city than New York City and smaller than Rochester, there's a little bit of that, not so much, but because my brother's here, we can certainly, at least the two of us can meet up after gigs and invite other guys. More likely we meet for breakfast. But it is a wonderful thing I found in a city not so big to have a community of musicians that actually hangs out, not just at gigs, but when they have free time.
I get the vibe that Kingston is following the Woodstock model, where you have your, 25 world touring musicians who all kind of know each other and aren't competing when they're in Woodstock. And then when they're on the road, it's a different story.
Well, it is very close to Woodstock. It's only down the road. And both places have an inordinate number of musicians who live there and artists. And so it's a good artistic area. Although most of us, of course, have no local gigs to do. We just go elsewhere to tour. And then we come home to be here.
Got it. And another random question from a fan of yours named Grog Zeichner. longtime fan. He mentioned an album that you did with David Torn, and he's wondering, is that the only album that you did on the ECM label?
That's the only, that was called Cloud Above Mercury, a really special and wild album, really great. I don't remember doing any others on the ECM label. I've done others with David Torn. Levin Torn White, for instance, we formed one of those project albums with three guys. I don't remember if I've done others with ECM. Probably not, or maybe I would remember it. But it was really special. David, I didn't know David at that time, although we both lived in Woodstock. And he just had such an open mind about his music that he thought, well, what if I brought in Bill Bruford and Tony Levin from King Crimson and they played on my kind of jazz, free, weird jazz stuff? What would that be like? We only found out in the studio, and it was a really excellent, excellent choice and a good example of an open-minded musician creating something that's quite a bit different than what he's done before.
In terms of the trio albums, over the years, we've seen a lot of fantastic combinations there. I remember there was one that was John Entwistle, Glenn Tipton from Judas Priest, and Cozy Powell on drums. Was there ever an attempt at getting you into a metal trio with those kinds of performers?
I have not been asked to join. I've been asked to do lots of what I call projects. Project is almost like almost a band. It could become a band, but if it's a project, you don't devote the time into it. Usually don't have the time to put into it to become a band. So I've never been asked to join a metal one that I can recall.
Well, two quick questions and then you're a free man. The first one comes out of nowhere. I was curious, were you ever close to working with David Lee Roth at any point in time? And I ask that because he seems to have liked a lot of people who were in the prog world. And I would have figured that after Billy Sheehan left his band, there was kind of a, hey, we need a guy who can really wow a lot of people. And you might have been on that short list.
Nope, never did. Would have liked it. You know, sometimes I'm asked, who would you like to have played with that you didn't get to? And really, like any musician, anybody who's good that I heard, especially if they're really good, that they're exciting. And boy, I wish I had played on that. You know, in a practical term, I don't spend my time pining away because I didn't play with it. But yeah, I would have loved to play with him. Had I been called and was I free, I would have done it for sure. And my musical life would have taken a turn. Who knows where?
Who knows? Well, the last question out of nowhere here. What's your favorite show on TV these days? Do you have a recommendation you could pass along?
I have a very clear answer to that. Some questions I can't answer clearly. I don't watch TV at all.
Wow.
I haven't for years. I'm not tempted anymore, but when I used to be tempted, I would just go up to the studio and play a little music or listen to music or do something musical or write or creative or read a book. So I'm not recommending that to everybody, but I don't even know. My wife watches TV and she tells me about some show. Schitt's Creek, she tells me it's a good show.
Great show.
But I don't watch. So that's a pathetic answer, but that's the truth.
You're a student of your craft and you're pretty busy with the road. Totally get it. But yeah. Thank you for your time and hope to see your gig in Queens in the very near future, man.
Thank you. And I appreciate your time also and the intelligence of your questions.
Thank you. Too kind, Tony. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Take care. Paltrocast.